Lord, you are my portion and cup. It is you who uphold my lot.
My heart is close to the pleasant land. Indeed, I have a God of goodly heritage.
I will bless the Lord who gives me counsel. My heart teaches me, night after night.
I have set the Lord always before me, because he is at my right hand, I shall not fall.
My heart therefore is glad, and my spirit rejoices. My body also shall rest in hope.
For you will not abandon me to the grave, nor let your Holy One see the pit.
You will show me the path of life. In your presence there is fullness of joy, and in your right hand are pleasures forevermore. And we have a brief prayer. We'll pray this together. Gracious God, we bless your holy name for the heritage you have given us. Show us the path of life that we may follow in hope and come unto the joy and resurrection of your Son, Jesus Christ. Amen.
Second reading is from the book of Peter. Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. By his great mercy, he has given a new birth into the living, a hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead, and into an inheritance that is imperishable, undefiled, and unfading, kept in heaven for you, who are being protected by the power of God through the faith for our salvation ready to be revealed in the last time. In this you rejoice, even if now for a little while you have had to suffer various trials, so that the genuineness of your faith, being more precious than gold, that though perishable is tested by fire, may be found to result in praise and glory and honor when Jesus Christ is revealed. Although you have not seen him, you love him. And even though you do not see him now, you believe in him and rejoice with an indescribable and glorious joy. For you are receiving the outcome of your faith, the salvation of your souls. Discover what the Spirit is saying to the church.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
The Holy Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ, according to John.
Glory to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
When it was evening on that day, the first day of the week, and the door of the house where the disciples had met was locked for fear of the Jews, Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." After he said this, he showed them his hands and his side. Then the disciples rejoiced when they saw the Lord. Jesus said to them again, "Peace be with you. As the Father has sent me, so I send you." When he had said this, he breathed on them and said to them, "Receive the Holy Spirit. If you forgive the sins of any, they are forgiven them. If you retain the sins of any, they are retained." But Thomas, who was also called the twin, one of the 12, was not with them when Jesus came. So the other disciples told him, "We have seen the Lord." But he said to them, "Unless I see the mark of the nails in his hands, and put my finger in the mark of the nails, and my hand in his side, I will not believe." A week later, his disciples were again in the house, and Thomas was with them. Although the doors were shut, Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." Then he said to Thomas, "Put your finger here and see my hands. Reach out your hand and put it in my side. Do not doubt, but believe." Thomas answered him, "My Lord and my God." Jesus said to him, "Blessed have you believed because you have seen me. Blessed are those who have not seen and yet come to believe." Now Jesus did many other signs in the presence of his disciples, which are not written in this book. But these are written so that you may come to believe that Jesus is the Messiah, the Son of God, and that through believing you may have life in his name. The Gospel of Christ.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
May the words of my mouth and the meditation of all our hearts be always acceptable in your sight, O Lord, our strength and our Redeemer. Amen. Please be seated. In that first reading from the Acts of the Apostles, we hear some of Peter's first speech. Some call it his first sermon. Okay. It's not long, but then it doesn't have to be. Long speeches aren't necessarily more effective. One commentator drew upon the example of the Gettysburg Address. It's 272 words. You can read it out loud in about 3 minutes. Did you know that Abraham Lincoln wasn't the only speaker that day as they dedicated the Civil War Cemetery at Gettysburg? The featured speaker was the former dean of Harvard University, a gentleman named Edward Everett. He spoke for 2 hours. And while I'm sure that there is a copy of his remarks somewhere in an archive of official Civil War memorabilia, I'd wager that we'd be hard-pressed to find anyone who could say anything about Mr. Everett's speech. But Abraham Lincoln speaks to the crowd from notes scribbled on the back of an envelope, and his brief speech is forever known as the Gettysburg Address. Hence, the effectiveness, indeed the importance of that which is said, does not rely on the word count. Next week, we'll hear some more of that speech. Then, while we stay in Acts, we'll see more of what life was like in those early days. The speech comes after a group of people have witnessed the Pentecost event. We'll have it at the end of May, but it's the tongues of fire and the rush of wind, and the disciples start speaking in the native language of the various people out on the street. Oh, by the way, during this sentence, we've reached a Gettysburg Address worth of words. Just giving you some reference. But getting back to Peter, he shares with the crowd our most basic truth, that Jesus of Nazareth, through whom God worked many wonders, was handed over to authorities, and they killed him. And then God raised him from the dead to show that death did not have the power to hold him. That right there lies at the core of everything we're doing here. Again, it's not a long message, but it's at the foundation of why we gather, why we have Sunday morning with the bread and the wine, why we baptize, why we pray for the sick and try to help people in need. But I got thinking about why. Why did it take a crucifixion and a resurrection? And after grinding away on it a bit, I thought about how God wants us to have full lives. I came that they might have life and have it abundantly, says Jesus, John 10, when he's talking about being the good shepherd. So having lived an abundant life, I think God would not want us to be fearful of what comes next. Live a good life. And when the time comes, which often does not mesh with our own desires, but what do we know? We're only human. When that time comes, we should not be so afraid of it, because there's more. We know because Jesus, because Easter, because of the resurrection, we know that there's more. That's been one of my favorite little jokes for a long time now. I love when we're at a potluck or a banquet or a buffet and they bring out my favorite thing, more. I think God doesn't want us to be afraid of the more. Yes, we don't know what's in store for us, but God knows, and God knows how much fear can get in our way. That evening, after Mary had come back from the tomb and told them that she had seen the Lord, they were afraid. Peter and John, we think it was John. Pardon me. They had confirmed that the stone had been rolled away and the body was gone. Anyone would likely suspect that his followers had done something to move his body. So yeah, they were afraid. Jesus comes into this frightened gathering, and straight away he bids them peace. He understands that he has to dispel the fear in the room, and let's face it, his sudden appearance is more likely going to add to the anxiety. Then it says that he showed them his hands and his side. I read one commentary that takes that to mean that they didn't truly believe until that moment. I think back to the story where Mary didn't recognize Jesus until he said her name. There had to be a little, I know you and you know me moment. And that's easy when all you have to do is call one person's name, but in a room of 11 or more, sorry, 10 or more, Thomas wasn't there, whose name do you call first? Who do you save to the end? What if a common experience that they could all share in together would have the same effect? There's an intimacy that comes with showing someone else your wounds, your vulnerability. The intimate moment with Mary was calling her name. With the men, it might have been Jesus triggering their memories because they knew how he got those wounds. And they had never seen them on anyone else. But the thing is that once they recognize him, they rejoice. The peace he has brought into the room abides. They can relax. The fear seems to be gone, for the moment at least. That's the peace we need to get us through troubled times. The peculiar thing is, in our heart of hearts, we understand that. Well, we understand that it's peace that's missing when we're stressed and anxious and feeling like we need some relief from the pressures of the world. The crazy thing is that too many times, too many people Look out in the world for the peace which the world cannot give. There is no shortage of alternative solutions that people will lean on. I won't try to list them. I'm sure you can think of many. You may have had experiences where someone you know has tried to find peace in all the wrong places. Peace. Maybe it was someone you love. Peace. Maybe it was you. Peace. Any list I might try to offer would be embarrassingly inadequate, but I do know that everything on it would have one thing in common. None of them would be Christ. It is the peace that Christ brings that sustains. And while I realize that what I'm saying might come across as a lot of noise in the face of real-world problems, and how does one get a hold of this peace anyway, let me remind you that you have access to that peace all the time, and it is already in you. It is the peace we share as we get ready to come to the table. I remember back in the 80s when the idea of passing the peace was introduced, and I felt a little funny saying peace to the people around me. I'm old enough to remember hippies doing that, and that was my frame of reference. And it just felt odd. I reconciled myself at the time with just saying good morning to people. Then a friend I met through youth ministry events, who was a priest in the diocese, said something very simply, and I never felt odd about it again. He said, "It's not your peace that you're sharing." Keep that in mind when the time comes. And remember that this is not the only place that you might come across the peace of Christ. He didn't just bless folks in the synagogues. People encountered Jesus in lots of different ways. Our gospel came from John's version today, and it's good because John shows a lot of various ways that people came across that peace. A whole bunch of people celebrate a wedding feast long after it looked like the wine was all gone. A teacher comes by night and leaves with more questions than he came with. A Samaritan woman drawing water at noon becomes an early evangelist. A blind man gains his sight and the confidence to sass the authorities. The sisters of a dead man confess their faith in Jesus. A paralyzed man walks away from a pool he longed to bathe in at Jerusalem. 5,000 people dine on a couple of fish and some loaves. Who would think that the peace of Christ could only be experienced one way? For Thomas, it was going to take seeing for himself, or so he thought. The old saying that seeing is believing is just a confession of another human weakness. But Thomas becomes a gatekeeper for the rest of us. When Jesus comes and Thomas has his moment and confesses, "My Lord and my God," it prompts Jesus to say that people are blessed who come to believe without seeing. That's us. We're not going to be able to see those marks. We can't put our finger in the holes or feel the flesh around the spear wound. So we come to our belief in other ways. And confessing a belief is good. But until it has a way to manifest itself, it can have an empty ring to it. Gathering for worship is a good start. We meet. We pray with and for each other. Even if there isn't a lot of interaction, we have personal evidence that we're not alone in this. There is a community of believers to which we're connected, and those connections can grow as strong and go as deep as we're prepared to let them. And sometimes we're good at that. And sometimes we need help. One thing that helps is that we share that peace which the world cannot give. The other side of that coin is that there are those who will say that they believe, but something still keeps them from gathering. And when I hear it in my head, I don't like the sound of, what's it going to take? But I keep coming back to, what's it going to take? I know there are lots of good reasons people have, and that's why I don't like the question. But somehow I feel that there are those out there who, for lack of a better word, hold on to a fear that hasn't yet met the peace of Christ. I think it falls to us, if we know anyone like that, to extend the invitation. Offer the peace. Remember, Thomas had his friends around him when he had his breakthrough. It's okay for people to have the scrutiny of Thomas. We need critical thinkers. We'd be in a lot of trouble without them. The peace of Christ is theirs just as much. 1,810 words. Sure wasn't any kind of Gettysburg address, but then I'm no Abraham Lincoln. Let's just be thankful I'm no Edward Everett either. You're welcome. God love you. Amen.
Thank you. renounce all sinful desires that draw you from the love of God.
I renounce them.
Do you turn to Jesus Christ and accept him as your Savior?
I do.
Do you put your whole trust in his grace and love?
I do.
Do you promise to obey him as your Lord?
Okay, we continue on page 155. Let us now pray for those persons, for this person who is to receive the sacrament of new birth. Deliver her, O Lord, from the way of sin and death.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Open her heart to your grace and truth.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Fill her with your holy and life-giving spirit.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Teach her to love others in the power of the Spirit. Send her into the world in witness to your love.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Bring her to the fullness of your peace and glory.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Grant, O Lord, that all who are baptized into the death of Jesus Christ, your Son, may live in the power of the resurrection and look for him to come in glory, who lives and reigns now and forever. Amen. Amen.
Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
We give you thanks, Almighty God and Father, for by the gift of water you nourish and sustain all living things.
Blessed be God forever.
We give you thanks that through the waters of the Red Sea you led your people out of slavery to freedom in the Promised Land.
Blessed be God forever.
We give you thanks for sending your Son Jesus. For us he was baptized by John in the River Jordan. For us he was anointed as Christ by your Holy Spirit. For us he suffered the baptism of his own death and resurrection, setting us free from the bondage of sin and death, and opening to us the joy and freedom of everlasting life.
Blessed be God forever.
We give you thanks for your Holy Spirit who teaches us and leads us into all truth, filling us with his gifts so that we might proclaim the gospel to all nations and serve you as a royal priesthood.
Blessed be God forever.
We give you thanks for you have called grace to new life through the waters of baptism. Now, sanctify this water that your servants who are washed in it may be made one with Christ in his death and resurrection, to be cleansed and delivered from all sin. Anoint them with your Holy Spirit and bring them to new birth in the family of your church, that they may become inheritors of your glorious kingdom. We give you praise and honor and worship through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, now and forever.
Blessed are you, our strength and song.
This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sin. Whenever you drink it, do this for the remembrance of me. Gracious God, his perfect sacrifice destroys the power of sin and death. By raising him to life, you give us life forevermore. Therefore, we proclaim the mystery of faith. Christ is God.
Christ is risen. Christ will come again.
of Victorian tea on Mother's Day weekend, May 13th, Saturday. Two seatings. Give the church a call if you need to reserve a spot or a bunch of spots. Please keep that in mind. It was always a well-attended event, and I think a lot of people are looking forward to its return. Just one word about baptisms, and now that Grace is off exploring. That's good. I'd like her to become, how do I say this subtly? I want her to become familiar with the place. My mother had a term. She would call us up when she had grandchildren, finally, and she'd call up. She was not so subtle. She would say, "I gotta do my interfering. When can I interfere in the lives of those kids?" So don't be surprised if every now and then you get a phone call from me. "I wanna do my interfering." She's a brand new Christian. She gets the run of the place now.
One very important one. We have coffee hour afterwards, a central part of the Anglican communion. So please come into the parish hall, have goodies, and there's stuff. Let Grace pick up, okay? That's practice. I would ask your prayers for the late Right Reverend Walter Aswell, former Bishop of Niagara, who died on Easter Sunday, for his wife Mavis and the family. And if you go on the diocesan website, there are details about the service. I also want to tell you that this afternoon a disturbance will arrive to this parish. A disturbance is what the former head of the Anglican Church, Fred Hiltz, called deacons gathering together. The deacons of Western New York and Niagara and Northwest Pennsylvania have been Zooming since June of 2020 when we couldn't gather, and we haven't missed a Monday. They're finally coming over this afternoon. We're having a party from 3 to 5, or the Yanks are coming. It should be loved. I want to tell you also about, in the bulletin, there's a group called Ruth and Naomi. They are two widows of the Old Testament. And we were thinking of starting a group for them with the assistance of some other deacons. The time for starting that is getting to a close. So if you are at all interested, please contact me no later than May 7th. I'm going to be away, by the way. Lori and I are going on a Mississippi cruise starting next Friday. So you can leave a message on the answering machine, and I'll try to think. I also would ask your prayers for Linda Learn of our 8 o'clock congregation. She's in hospital. She's slowly improving. But Strong Fort Erie Neighborhoods, our ecumenical coalition that provides meals every Wednesday and personal products, will help us do that. So the meal will go forward on the fourth Wednesday. I think that's really important. It's a group of churches and people, some who don't go to church, gathering together to look after the needs of those who require assistance.
Need help with meals.
Yeah.
Anything else that would be good for the rest of us to hear?
Yeah.
Great to see you, this time. All right, Pastor Abel, would you please stand? We'll have a blessing and carry on the Sunday. Hold fast to your faith that it may move you to act with integrity and promote justice, to choose kindness and dare to love. And the blessing of God Almighty, Holy Creator, Christ and Spirit be with you and work through you among those whom you love, today and always. Amen.
Hallelujah. Christ is risen. Go in peace to love and serve the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Hallelujah.